Welcome everyone to our gathering tonight. It's wonderful to be here at Western Link, and thank you for reading your emails and telling your members that there's been a change in venue. As you saw, it was meant to be Croydon Park, and we're going to have the renovations all finished by the middle of October, and you would have had a nice fresh place to come and christen. But workmen are workmen. And you know how things go. Things get put on hold and take a bit longer than planned. So we're hoping sometime soon renovations will be finished and we can enjoy the new things. And we will have another gathering there, probably not next year, but the year after, because next year is booking up very quickly in our gatherings, which you'll hear a bit about later where the next one is. So thank you to Western Link for coming to the rescue at the last minute. And hopefully, maybe some might still roll in if they didn't read their emails and they came to Croydon Park and saw the signs on the fence. And the Riverland, we were having them join us, but someone didn't read the schedules around and they decided to take the computer home because they were needing the computer for the following Sunday service. And the old computer there does not match up with Skype. So they're thinking of us in our prayers, and we'll be thinking of them during this time. So let's come together in our call to worship and opening prayer. The Spirit of the Lord is upon us to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, to release the prisoners, to comfort all who mourn, to repair the ruined cities. Prepare the way of the Lord. Let us pray. Christ of the broken, Christ of the wanderer, Christ of those without shelter, surround those in deep need here in South Australia and around the world. Surround them and help them to hear, so we can hear their cries of help. We are a people who long for the broken to be mended. Help us to reach beyond ourselves through our support, through our mission that you have given us to do. Help us to share your ministry into this world. In Jesus' name, amen. Karen, if you stay put and if this doesn't work in the next few bits, I'll give you the nod when you need to change slides. Because there's a few slides that will need changing. Isn't mission fantastic? It's doing what we are called to do. And there's so many books, there's so many songs written about mission. One which I rediscovered last weekend. Paul and I were heading towards the Barossa Valley, and on the nice old, you know, the iPod things, we've got a number of albums recorded there, and for a change, we thought we'd take a trip down memory lane and play ELO. Now, who remembers the Electric Light Orchestra? Yes, a few hands are waving. And there's a song called Mission. So even back then, they were writing songs about mission. And in this song, it's talking about these aliens travelling from a distant place and time to a place called the planet Earth. Now, from way up there, planet Earth is beautiful and blue and floating softly through a rainbow. But when they touched down, they discovered things were a bit different here. The place was dirty and worn out. There was a mother and a baby sitting on the streets, crying through the veil she had on. And there was someone else singing from a window. And there was a building in the corner, in a city, in this land which they arrived at, on this place they call the planet Earth. Now, it almost sounds like a church site, or maybe a cafe, could be a hospital. There's so many places it could be where you go to do outreach. And as the song goes on, my orders are to sit here and watch the world go by from a mission of this sacred heart. And the chorus, which repeats to the trainee verses, watching all the days roll by. Who are you and who am I? Is that the mission? Is that the mission we know and understand? Now, obviously, this church or these writers do not belong to the Community Outreach Mission Network. Because we're all here for mission. Our focus is on mission. And mission is more than just talking to people. It's more than just making connections with people. We've been called to make disciples out of nations. And we hear in the Bible, in Matthew 28, verses 16 to 20. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you to do. And remember, I am with you always, to the end of the age." We're called to do mission, to make disciples. So how does this picture relate to our Bible passage today about mission? Any ideas? Let me give you another hint. Mission Impossible. It's the movie starring Tom Cruise. And there's been 5 movies now. Mission Impossible, next one. Mission Impossible 2. Mission Impossible 3. Mission Impossible Ghost Protocol. Yes, and Mission Impossible Rogue Nation. Now, these movies, they have action. They have elegance. They have beauty. They have a team working together. And it's based on a TV show that was popular back in the 1960s. Who used to watch Mission Impossible? The spy story with mystery and excitement. An old TV show that always began in the same way. Secret agent Jim Phelps would receive on a modern device a tape recorded message which said, "Jim, your mission, if you choose to accept it, is..." And then it would give him the assignment, which seemed impossible to accomplish. And of course, he always accepted the mission. And there's always the phrase after the introduction was said, saying, what was the comment on the machine? "This tape will self-destruct in 5 seconds. And then he would choose his group of agents, each one having a special talent, who would help him accomplish this mission. And as you might guess, the super agents formed the Mission Impossible Force. And they were always able to complete their mission. We have all been given a mission by Jesus. Our mission is to tell the whole world about Jesus, about his love, about his forgiveness for all people. We've been told to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that Jesus has commanded them and us to do. Now, at times, that would seem like an impossible mission. But it isn't. Because we never have to do it alone. The church is like the Mission Impossible Force Team. It's made up of many people. Each of us. Each and every one of us. We have a special talent. We all have a special gift that God has given us. And if we choose to accept our mission, then the Mission Impossible becomes Mission Possible. How about you? Are you willing to accept your mission? Now, I'm sure that's why we're all here tonight. Because we have a mission. And we're needing to find different ways to fulfill that mission, to outreach. We are utilizing the gifts, the skills, the talents that God has given us to use so that we can complete the mission that God has organized for each and every one of us. We have a wonderful God. You only have to look around at the world, the creation, the beauty, the wonder of it. You only have to reflect back on times in the journey of your life to see when God has been there in that journey, when he's helped you, when he's strengthened you, when he's given you the ability to do what you need to do. So you can achieve all. You can achieve it with the strength of God, the power of prayer, and the comfort and the support of all those within your congregation, all those within the network, all those who are around you. So are we ready to continue our mission, to journey into the days, the weeks, the years ahead, and do what God needs us to do? Because we can do it. Because God is with us. Let us pray. God, you sent your Son Jesus to show us the way to minister to others. Help us to listen to those who are downtrodden or forgotten. Be close to those who are without work and those who are overworked. Those who are sick or captive. Those who are ignored because they're too young or they're too old. Those who are lonely and alone. Especially those from whom this is a new and dreadful feeling. We pray for parents who worry about their children and for children who worry about their parents. Our hearts go out to all victims of violence. We pray for the tormented nations of the world. And especially, we pray for children who are victims of sudden violence. Shepherd them all greatly, we pray. And Heavenly Creator, you have given us all a mission. May each of us be willing to accept our mission and help to share your wonderful message in this world that you have given us. Help us in all we do, for we are doing it to bring your glory into this world. Amen. So may the Christ who walks on wounded feet walk with you on the road. May the Christ who serves with wounded hands stretch out your hands to serve. May the Christ who loves with a wounded heart open your heart to love. And when you leave this place, may you see the face of Christ in everyone you meet. And may everyone you meet see the face of Christ in you. I pray that to be true in your life and in mine. Amen.
Good evening and welcome, welcome as well. And I'd like to thank a few people first. First of all, we'll thank Croydon Park for the devotions. That's Paul and Brian, thanks for that. Also, a thank you to Western Link, the Western Link people out in the kitchen and cleaning up and getting things ready for us. That's really fantastic. Also, a special thank you to Lorraine Ditschke, who has been doing our videoing for some time. We've never actually said thank you to Lorraine, so we're really sorry for that, Lorraine. These days, if someone hasn't been to the gathering and they want to have a look at what's gone on, it's now on our website. So there's a YouTube clip attached through our website, the Community Outreach Mission Network website. So anyone who isn't here who wants to be here, they can always see it that way. So that's that stuff. Now we've got some apologies tonight. Jenny Escotts, Diane Bury, Angie Griffin, David Badger, Jenny Walker, Douglas Monahan didn't make it, did he, Douglas? No, he wasn't sure, and Lynn Lean. Is there anyone else who you would like their apologies recorded?
Yes, Don Hopwood.
Don Hopwood.
And Terry and Leanne instead.
Terry and Leanne instead as well, thank you very much for that.
Mark Hewitt.
Thank you for that one.
Ian
Lomeyer. Ian Lomeyer, thank you.
Jeff Lister.
You getting all these or are you just going to get off the table?
Yeah,
okay, getting off the table, sorry, who else was that?
Mari Thompson,
thank you for that. Okay, that's fantastic. Have we got any people for whom this is the first Community Outreach Mission Network gathering they've been to? There we are, thank you, welcome. Oh.
Oh.
No, look, that's a bit naughty.
I was waiting for you to react.
Well,
I haven't been here in person.
You've been here Skype before.
That's true.
You have been to Skype before.
It depends how you find what you said.
Okay, Glenys. It's Glenys Badger from Barmera. So, she's come even further than the K-Night, so welcome. there was someone else here.
Jill and Bruce.
Jill and Bruce, welcome as well. That's fantastic.
And our colleague Wilt has returned.
Yes, she has. She's back again.
Couldn't resist myself.
You couldn't resist yourself, I know. And how's Wollonga going?
Lovely.
That's great. Fantastic. Okay. It also says on my piece of paper, because I always do as I'm told, Brian's told me what to say. Well, sometimes I do as I'm told. Our next gathering, by the way, will be at Broadview. And that'll be on Wednesday, the 27th of January, which we'll put out. In the same sort of start with food. We're going to be talking, though, about the Community Outreach Mission Network grants. That is, those that have received grants, we'll be talking about what they've done with the money and how it's worked out for them. So, that'll be great. Okay. Now, we have some cards here. Now, the ones I'm aware of, and Brian can tell me about the other one, is that this one says you like what's happening and you're supportive. This one says that you're very cold and you don't like it, and the answer's no. So that's yes and that's no, essentially. And I'm assuming this one means you don't know.
No. Well, yes, you don't know. So, if you don't know and you think, what on earth are they talking about? I have a question. So if you have a question, something you want to ask, you hold up your yellow card.
Because in sin I'd behold both up together.
Yes. So that confuses me. If I said yes and I didn't know, I think somebody would ask myself.
So This isn't a confusion, it's just that we should do things by those sort of processes. Now, we have distributed the AGM minutes from last time, and you've had a chance to read them. Has anyone got any questions about those minutes, or will someone like to move they are received? No one likes the minutes, Brian, sorry.
All those hours I put into writing up.
I know. okay, is Jeff, do you want to move that we receive the
reading? I will so move.
Okay, we'll have a second for that. Yeah, it's good, got a second, thanks, Cliff. So all those in favour, if you are, could you hold up that one? And if you don't, put up the blue one. Oh, thank you, we do have consensus, that's lovely. Okay. Now, there's been an annual report which I've written and it's already been off to Synod. If anyone's got any questions about that report, it was there as attachment 2 in what was sent out. Any questions? Going, gone, thank you for that. Now, a budget proposal. If we can just have the budget up, please. We've sent a budget around as well as an attachment, but some people always want to know where the money goes. And you will see there that we're looking to have a, oops, sorry about that. We're looking to have a an extra $9,000 essentially above for income above expenditure. So we're looking to have another positive year. At this stage, we in fact have $82,600 in our account. So we certainly are not going broke. I ask you to remember that because that means we'll have about $90,000 at the end of next year if everything stays the same. This year we increased Brian's hours so that he was now half-time, he wasn't quite half-time before. So he's, and also Brian is now a pastor for us under the normal rules of the United Church. So it's been formalised, that came out of last year's meeting as well. So that's happened. With the budget, we are required to seek approval for that. So if I could have, if there's questions about, first of all, is there questions about the budget? Yes.
Just note that we're probably only going to have spend half of what we budgeted for the $800 grants.
Yes.
So I assume there's plenty of opportunity for congregations to make use of that.
There is indeed. I know one congregation which should have put a grant in, which I won't mention. But yeah, there are certainly opportunities for grants. Any other questions about the budget? Don't anyone want to feel pressured? Would someone like to move that we... thank you, Anne. I've got a second for that. Anne, what? Got a second? Yes. Sorry about your name.
Do you want to take it on?
Sorry.
Bellevue.
Yes. Okay. Anne. So those who are supportive of the budget, could you please indicate? Okay, I don't see any blue ones, so that's consensus. Now, our proposal for the budget is that the grant stay at $800 per successful application, and that has been a question that has been discussed before. Are people happy for us to stay with $800 as being the amount that maximum amount for a grant, for any one grant, or does someone have an alternative view?
Thanks.
certainly...
It doesn't take long to say I don't have a class.
Not at all.
Another reason for that level is in fact to encourage as many as possible to access that. But the reality is that only half the amount of dollars of the budget or has been accessed.
Yes.
So that might just suggest something about the level that should be set for that.
So
then again, you don't want people to want to start a project and expect the network to fund the whole lot. That's the other issue.
Okay. Yes, question.
The grants at the moment are for new projects, correct?
Or an extension of an existing one.
If
you're doing an existing one and there's something new you want to do within that project, you can also apply.
Okay.
So it's not, when we first started, it was always for only you, especially Karen, when you were on the team. But now we've been more generous or more flexible in that. Yeah, we still do require someone to be financial before they can get a grant. And we try not to give the same aid congregation more than one grant in 1 year. And if they've got multiple projects that are quite different, well, that's a different story, but we try not to do that. Yes? Yes?
I'd like to move that it be $1,000.
Okay. What is people's feeling on $1,000? Okay, well, it's now $1,000. Well done. Thank you for that.
Who moved?
Bruce.
Bruce?
Bruce
Davis.
Bruce.
Sorry, Bruce.
Davis. Okay.
Any second?
I did apply the consensus, but okay, if you want to be second,
yes.
Karen's a second, but that's legal for those who like legal. The next thing is actually the contribution, which has been at 2% for quite some time, and the executive have become a little weary of continually coming back and saying we'd like to reduce it. So this time we've just said it is to remain at 2%, but we're certainly there's some questions around this, and that is that even with the $1,000 now for grants, we're still going to have a substantial amount of money still in around. This could mean that we decide to fund some projects outside of community outreach. And I certainly don't want to ambush anyone tonight with a quick fix for where that money might go. But we are aware that Frontier Services had a big meltdown financially, and that we're only going to have one patrol person in South Australia for next year. And not only that, he doesn't have a motor vehicle.
Or a house.
Or any equipment. So that's one of the suggestions which was floated.
It's roughly 6,000 for the vehicle on the road.
Yeah. And then there's the question of, we've supported in the past the prison ministry and so on. So there's a range of things where that money could go. Or you could decide that you'd rather just reduce the amount that you pay. So I just floated out there, and we could have some comment on whether people think that the executive should look at bringing a recommendation to the next gathering as to where some excess funds might go, or how that money might be spent, or whether you'd like to reduce your contribution. So it's really open to what people think. Yes. Yes.
3 months without a motor vehicle for Frontier Services is really not going to work.
No.
I suggest we would have to
contact everyone on our list and ask for them to give a response within a certain time whether they agree or didn't agree. We could actually get around it that way. It's just because in our financial agreements between with us and Synod is that we've got a limit for how much money the executive can spend in a without any other approvals, and certainly the sort of money we'd need to support, say, the front end services question, we would need the gathering to support. So we could get around it in a different way, but it would have to be like, yes.
How much did you say the vehicle, are you using?
60,000. So that's the vehicle plus all the navigation stuff that's needed, all the, so roughly 60,000 to be on the road.
Yes, it's for the STIRP, the parking or STIRP patrol, depending on whatever else you call it.
It's that one.
And so that would be a possibility as to what we might do. I guess I'm uncomfortable for us to actually make that decision tonight, unless the meeting wants to, because I feel that you've been ambushed, in a sense. Okay.
We wouldn't have to fund the entire vehicle.
No, we might give 20,000 or 30,000 or something or other towards it, which would be a substantial help to ensuring it happens in the new year. So that's a possibility. Is the mood of the gathering that we stay at 2%? Could I have an indication, please? Okay, fine. Thank you very much. I've got one blue.
I think it would be a good idea for it to be 2%, but with congregations that are struggling financially, to be granted a reduction in that.
That's something that we already do. Congregations which have a problem like that write to us, to the exec. And there hasn't been any congregation that we haven't supported in that way if they've got problems.
That's right.
So in that case, are you willing to stand aside or give you thank you? Okay, we have consensus on that too. The key liaison person for this network is me. However, if someone else would like the job, tonight's the night where you get the job. All it means is that you are a co-opted member of Synod. When either Synod or Presbytery want to engage the network in any issue, you're the person that things are channeled through. And when we have combined network meetings of some sort, the key liaison person is required to be at that and contribute. So that's the sort of job it is. It's not a very heavy job most of the time, but if someone else would like the job, please stand up. I don't see anyone else. I can't move that I am a key liaison person.
So do we have nominations for key liaison person?
Yeah.
Alan Barnes, do I have a second? Oh, hang about. Any other nominations? No? Okay, so do I have someone to move that Alan Barnes?
Yeah.
And the second was Karen.
Karen, the second. All in favour? Oh, congratulations.
Thank you. It's quite interesting. This was the first gathering where I actually chair the gathering, and I am hopeful it will be the last time I do it for some time, because I'm seeking a different chairperson next year. With the PRC and pastoral care rep, that's actually part of Brian Dunstan's employment contract, so all we can do is congratulate him. Tonight, I'll have to cry in my sleep tonight because she's off the team. But they've done a wonderful thing, and I think it'd be great if we could just give them a round of applause. The following people have indicated that they would like to be on the executive for next year. That's Brian and I, David Pryor, who's currently over in Afghanistan, Douglas Monaghan, Jeff Tiller, Glenys Badger, Mark Hewitt, and Rebecca Perlin. Now, if there's anyone else here, this is the way we usually do it, if there's anyone else here who would also like to be on the team, now's your chance. In which case, I'd like to congratulate the executive team. The pastoral care team is still in flux, but it certainly will be operating next year. And members of the grant approval team is Ryan Dunstan, Peter Moss, and Ruth Selleck. So they are the three people who are the grant approval team. Okay. Is there anything else from an AGM point of view that anyone would like to raise at this point? Well, if you haven't, thank you for your contributions to the AGM. That was quick and clean, I hope, and not too long. Yes?
A question. I remember just last time we met as a mission councillor in Alpha, yep. We talked about your letter to us.
Yep.
And the future of the network.
Yes.
And I think we agreed to send some thoughts in writing.
Good.
But I'm just wondering what others have done and whether that's part of what you intended to do tonight, because I thought that may be what you were going to do.
Well, it was. All I've got back is two other responses. Both of them were extremely positive, and they were saying that the network needs to continue because of its ability to deal with diversity, its ability and focus on the community rather than itself. So they were positive things which sort of are at the core of what this network has been from the start. I also put it there because I was trying, when we first started, in the first couple of years, we had a very rigorous review process on this particular gathering. And during that time, good ideas came up, but really the real underpinning of what the network is and what it tries to do never changed. It was always the embroidery question, stuff around the edges. It was never the core of what the network is. I guess there's another way to look at the question. If congregations aren't happy with the network, they're always free to join another one. Or if they think that there's something we really need to change, this is the meeting, in fact, to bring those issues forward. So, Ross, are there things that you know that you think need to change?
I'm just asking the
yes.
question. Then, are we saying tonight that we continue with COMN as it is?
We are.
Or are we going to have a discussion on it?
We are, unless you would like a discussion. If you like a discussion, we will have a discussion.
We were just concerned that a decision would be made without any further discussion.
Mm.
We didn't, because we're certainly in favour of mm-hmm. continuing, and we're certainly in favour of the ethos and the theological aspect of this. So our council said yes, we would want it to continue.
Okay, well that's three, that's good.
But Alan, it just seems to be, I would have thought an appropriate thing to do to have a conversation together as the network. Because as we talk to each other, you might be surprised at what comes out of that. You may not be either, by the way, but I mean, unless we do that talking and discussion and so on at various points in our life, then nothing ever changes and we don't move forward. So, and I'm not suggesting anything needs to good thing to have on our agenda to do those kinds of things. So that's why we felt in our meeting at home.
Yeah, thanks, Rob. And that's really why I wrote the words I did, because I was, because I've been on executive since the network started. And I was wondering whether I'd just become stale and whether I'd just sort of got to accept whatever's going on versus, you know, where's the enthusiasm, where's the spark sort of question. And so that was part of the reason that I wrote it. But it was also, I guess, to try to generate some ideas. So certainly, this is a good opportunity if people would like to talk about how they see the network changing or being different or whatever they might think. Yes?
I'm wondering if our next gathering, can we set, say, 15 minutes aside to do that, because I'm aware time is getting on and we've still got Mark to bring us his part, and that will give people more time to talk about and come with the slice of things written down.
That's certainly, we could certainly do that. This is the tension that there always is with the, because in the past these AGMs have been so quick and we haven't really got into discussions as such. We have got a speaker who is, even though he's injured, is here with us. Would people prefer, could I just have a show with your cards whether you'd like the discussion tonight? Okay, thank you for that. We'll have the executive will bring forward a discussion, I hope, for the time after. Next gathering. Yes?
But I don't think 15 minutes is enough.
I don't think it is either.
No,
yes.
I was going to say that when we first started, we had whole meetings that were the focus on what we're doing.
Yep.
And might it be appropriate for the first meeting next year to be that type of meeting?
We certainly could do that. Okay, well, thank you for raising that, Ross. Yes, Paul.
I was just going to suggest that we share ideas and things we've done around dinner tables.
We could have even little sort of notes for people to write on and sit around tables during the meal and bring that to the gathering itself, rather than so that it's in a more intimate relationship where people are more willing to share their thoughts.
And that would
make
more discussion.
Yes. Yes. Thanks for that, Paul. Yes, Glenys.
I'm not sure if we're Skyping to Barbara tonight because I'm going very late.
No, we're not, because someone's got the wrong computer. Someone took it home.
Radio, that's fine. Just in terms of the suggestion for next time, that would be really hard for us to be involved in that sort of discussion.
I guess we could ask whether you're able to have that discussion first and bring some stuff to us, maybe. We can talk about that on Tuesday.
Sure. If you like. Just in terms of the format, that was all I was thinking.
Yes. Okay. Okay, well, I'm glad we've had some discussion, even though it's been cut short and there's some good ideas as to how we might move that forward. Okay, it's now my pleasure to invite Mark to grab his crutches and come aboard. I have been joking in our congregations that we asked Mark to speak because most of our congregations are mental and they need a bit of help. But that's not quite true at all. And thank you for making you want to and over to you. So over to Mark.
My name is Mark Boyce, and for the last 18 years, I've been working as a chaplain in the mental health service across both the north and the western areas of Adelaide. 18 years ago, I started up at Lyell McEwen Hospital. They had a mental health unit up there that I started working in. And after a while, that ministry actually broke out of the hospital and started into the community. Many of the people I was working with were saying to me, Mark, I actually need to see you more often and I need to see you when I get home. Can we do coffee? Those kinds of things. And from there, I started working in some of the rehabs, did all kinds of groups and stuff within the rehabs around the place. And I've actually had a ball for the last 18 years. And I've really enjoyed the ministry that I've had. And I've been fortunate to be able to do that on a very regular basis. Prior to that, I nursed. So I nursed for about 18, 20 odd years. So I came with a whole bag of experience that's been really good for me to be able to use within the mental health arena. And I've been fortunate to do that. Now, tonight you've asked me to come along and do some stuff on mental health. And again, more than happy to do that. What I'm going to give you tonight is some of the stuff I'd actually do for some of the groups I run. So what I've actually developed over the years is an 8-week program of about 2.5 hours each week, looking at the various mental health issues that people experience, and also providing people with some basic kind of pastoral care kind of skills about how we can more effectively walk alongside people who experience mental health problems. And again, for me, that's been really important because for a lot of people, I often find that they're a bit frightened of making a mistake and what will happen. So it's about really helping people to kind of overcome the fear, the ignorant stuff, and to be able to then provide that kind of mental health, kind of pastoral care to people in a way that's going to be life-giving for people. So again, for churches and congregations, I'm actually happy to come and run those courses for people. So if your congregation decides, or you may decide as a community network, gee, I'd love to hear some more about that, I'm happy to do that. Provide that kind of for congregations. And that's happening more and more these days because what we're actually finding is people are getting the support they need within the mental health system and they're often lobbing up into congregations and churches looking for that kind of help. And I think more and more that will happen for people. As we begin, we might just do some discussion kind of stuff between each of you. In twos or threes. But what I want you to look at first is just to discuss with, in twos or threes, what is it that we actually need in order to have good mental health? What are the things we need in order to have good mental health? So physically, socially, psychologically, emotionally, spiritually, all those kinds of things. What is it we actually need in order to have good mental health? Take the time to talk to the person next to you now about what is it we need in order to have good mental health. So take the time now. Okay, everyone. What did you come up with? What did you come up with? What ideas, what thoughts? Normally I write them up, but I'm not walking, so. What did you come up with? What do we need in order to have good mental health?
Positive attitude.
Positive attitude.
Yes. Support.
Support.
Like emotional, physical, and medical support.
Yep. Now, support is really important, by the way. There's lots of research that would say in order to be well, we actually need 20 people around us. Now that's not acquaintances, by the way. That there are people we need around us who know us well, who care for us, who allow us to also care for them, but we need at least 20 people around us in order to be well. And those people act a bit like a trampoline. And if you don't have those people around, your potential or your ability to bounce back after something goes wrong, it gets harder and harder and harder. And for a lot of people I would work with, they may have one or perhaps two people. And so that idea of support is really important for people. It's actually important for us. But it's more important for people to experience those mental health problems because they need those people in order to be able to bounce or recover and have that kind of support. Yeah. What else did you come from?
Self-worth.
Self-worth, yeah. And we need that stuff within us, don't we, that actually says we're okay and that we can actually get through this, yeah?
Lucky genes.
Lucky genes, yes. Does anyone here have lucky genes?
You're lucky if you do, let me tell you.
Yep.
Physical health and physical exercise.
Yeah. And again, we need not just that physical health stuff, but it also involves maintaining our system well and keeping our system fit, healthy, diet, all those kinds of things are really important. Yep. Cliff?
Hope. Something to look forward to.
Yeah. And again, in the mental health system, we would use the recovery model. The recovery model would actually say that, yes, you've had a mental health problem, and yes, there will be kind of things that you need to get through and realise that there are some things you can't do like you used to be able to do, but there's still a possibility that you can get on with your life. And the other thing they talk about is hope and the need for hope. So hope is really important if we're actually going to stay well and be well, by the way. And again, if you've spoken to people and you hear despair and those kinds of things, there's no hope there, is there? So it's actually helping people to have hope and stay hopeful that's important. Yeah?
Feeling comfortable in saying no.
Feeling comfortable in saying no, yes. It's having good boundaries, isn't it? And unfortunately within our Christian church sometimes, we're not very good at that, are we? We like to be nice all the time. And that can get us into trouble as well. Yeah.
Is it some two-edged sword of faith can either be a positive thing or it can be a negative?
It can be, but again, what the research, and again, I did a whole research project around spirituality, mental health, and chaplaincy, by the way. And for people who are in recovery or who have mental health problems, faith or spirituality is one of their main resources. And it's actually not, what they've discovered is it's not actually the spirituality or the religion that causes the illness. But those things actually flare or get distorted when the illness comes along. And so having people that actually help us to listen to our stories and to hear our stories of faith and to help us work our way through that is actually really important. Again, a lot of my role in chaplaincy is actually hearing what people are saying and supporting their faith. Whatever that faith is, by the way. But again, when I can do that, people actually recover well. And there's lots of evidence again to suggest that people who have faith or spirituality recover quicker and stay well for longer. It's amazing.
But Peter was saying that sometimes in churches people say you shouldn't feel depressed because you're a Christian.
Oh, yeah.
So that was for the church.
Okay, yeah. But again, that's coming with expectations.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure sometimes those expectations are healthy within the life of church. And again, I think we need to be quite careful with how we use language within the life of the church and how that language affects people. And again, over the years, I've worked with lots of people and my language has changed considerably over the years. In fact, I don't talk about sin much anymore when I'm with my people. I'll talk about brokenness or barriers or the fact that we've made a mistake. Those kinds of things, but I won't actually use the word sin anymore with lots of people because it comes loaded. And again, there's lots of stuff within our Christian faith that can actually put expectations on people that aren't realistic or healthy. And for me, that's not what the gospel is about. So again, having a healthy spirituality is really important. Anything else? Yeah, Jeff?
Getting a good night's sleep.
Yes. Actually, sleep is really important. And I would actually say you need 8 to 9 hours sleep a night. And if you're not getting 8 to 9 hours sleep a night, you're actually starting to push yourself into stress. They actually say you can catch some of that up. So you know when you have your Sunday afternoon nap?
Not Sunday morning.
Not Sunday morning. No, I don't sleep during Sunday morning. But you can actually catch some of it up. But once that 7-day period is gone, you can't catch it up. It's lost to you. And again, we often push our systems to the point where we're actually not getting the sleep we need. And what that means is our brain can't actually defrag. We can't sort through things or work out what we're going to keep or not keep. And again, we need to be able to do that. So sleep is really important. In fact, I've got one of my people that if she loses 1 hour of sleep a night for a period of time, she becomes unwell. So it's quite important.
Yeah. Getting back to your earlier comment about communities, a lot of what we're talking about is people within a community, but I wonder about health of communities themselves of which they are part. So for example, in an area that has high unemployment, there's a whole kind of community that gets affected, and that affects the individuals or people in the asylum seekers. The whole community, there are plenty of people around, but it doesn't function in a way because the community itself is no.
We lived in Davern Park. Has anyone been to Davern Park for a while? We lived in Davern Park for over 4 years. And again, the environment there was, can anything good come from Davern Park? It actually affected people. I mean, one of the things people valued about coming to the church there was it actually provided a sense of hope and a different kind of environment for people to be in, where they actually thought, actually, something good can come from Davern Park. So again, environment's really important. And the effect it has on people,
Unfortunately, too, today, the news with all the unemployment, I think that really can put a lot of pressure on people to the point that depression and everything else can stem from that. To be in a position not to be working, but still be at a pot age, I just can't imagine the power of
that. Well, I struggle with that too. I do at the moment, in a way, but again, the stuff with the news is really important. I don't tend to watch news much these days, simply because it's bad news.
Okay.
And I think what we've done is we've lost the balance of good news. And I think you need the balance of both. And the Western world seems to have got kind of just focused in on the negative. And we need the balance of having that good stuff that encourages and nurtures,
Learning to look forward and not dwell on bad things in the past.
That's right, And again, one of the things I find with a lot of the people I work with is this issue of shame. I mean, we would call it stigma, but I think shame is a really big one for people. And shame is different to guilt. Shame actually tears at who you are and says you're no good. Guilt's a bit different. Guilt says you've done the wrong thing and you pay the fine, and you're off and up. Running again, but shame tends to tear at people, and for a lot of people who experience mental health problems, shame is a biggie, because it actually often comes from a trauma base. A lot of people I work with have stories of trauma, and it's been unresolved, and then they get diagnosed with a mental illness, which again slams them with another dose of shame, and again that's a big issue. And again, I think it's something within the life of the church we need to think about. Within our Christian culture, we've got really good at looking at guilt and forgiveness as a model. And I think it's important, by the way. Guilt and forgiveness are a very important model. But for people who have shame, what they often can't do is hear the forgiveness. So we need to actually help them to deal with the shame first. And there's actually lots of writing done on shame these days. But again, I think it's an important model or concept for us as church to be able to pick up. And to be able to help people to heal from shame first, so they can hear a different story. Jeff?
We've just got to be careful with our language, even here in church. Sort of, one of the ladies, my neighbourhood is, sort of said, you're stupid. I said, no, I'm not stupid, I've just done something that's stupid. I think we need to kind of grab.
And we'll look at language.
Make that little differentiation.
And we'll look at language in a minute. That's fine. Hey, so again, what you... Yep, sorry?
I do observe that the young ones are a lot more depressed now than years ago because of broken, marriages.
Look, there is stats out now that's saying that by 2020, depression will be the second major illness we're dealing with within our community. It's not far away. If you're interested in doing some reading, I would suggest you check out an author called Seligman, Martin Seligman. Has anyone heard of him? I love the stuff he does, and I think it's really helpful. We, within mental health, we would run groups around his material. He would actually say that the rates of depression are rising, he would say around the Second World War that someone would get diagnosed with depression around the age of 34. He would say that's dropped now to the age of 14. So he would say that there's something not good about our Western culture. And the more cultures become westernised, guess what? The rates of depression actually go up. And he'd also say that the rates of anxiety would go up as well. People who often experience depression will also have anxiety as a precursor to what's going on. So again, he would say that there are a lot of reasons why that is happening. And again, I think it's important that we're aware of that. But again, he's done some really good writing around it. He was the thinker in residence here in Adelaide for a while. And he also, a lot of schools are now running his material around the idea of flourishing. Has anyone heard of the flourishing stuff? Yeah. He's actually got an excellent website. If you want to look at his website and actually have a look, it's all downloadable. He's just providing it for people. It's just amazing. So he does provide that material for people. So it's worth having a look at and worth getting aware of.
And another thing about is the ability to forgive. We talk about shame and forgiveness, but a lot of people carry that sense that they won't or they can't forgive for a past, and that has an effect on their health.
Oh, yes. And again, one of the best authors, again, I've written on forgiveness is Seligman. Seligman actually has a whole process of helping people to forgive. In the life of the church, we just simply say, oh, you just need to forgive. If someone says that to me, I'm likely to hit them. Because, for me, it takes a lot for me to be able to forgive and work through the process of forgiveness. I have to actively be involved in it and actively do it on a daily basis sometimes in order for that process to be able to work. And so it's actually helping people to weigh up what happens if they don't. And again, we need to be quite proactive. But again, it's one of the gifts that we have within the life of the church, is that ability to access that kind of forgiveness. And I think we need to make that more available to people.
Just
wondering,
you confirm the spelling of Seligman?
Seligman.
Yeah. In the December newsletter, I'll have all these things put in there, so read your newsletter or check out the website, and Mark will give us a list of these ones so you don't have to worry about it.
So again, let me just reinforce, there are a lot of things that actually keep us well, and we need to be able to focus on those. And I would like to suggest that there are lots of things that we do within the life of our church communities that we do well, that actually help people to stay well. And again, there's lots of stuff that we do that we don't even think about. And again, even the idea of giving thanks is actually something people can do that actually helps keep them well. Martin Seligman challenges people to actually write down twice a day for 2 weeks three things they want to give thanks for. And it can be simply things like getting your feet on the floor in the morning, or being able to get through the day that they're thankful for. But after 2 weeks, people were actually starting to get well. It's amazing, isn't it? But within our heritage, we have this idea of giving thanks, of appreciating things, of savouring things. We have the idea of forgiveness. We have the idea of being able to have connection with a spirituality that gives life and hope. So we have a lot of those things within our communities already, but sometimes we just take them for granted and know they're there, but we need to actually help empower people to pick them up. Yeah. Now within the notes, you'll see there's a definition of what is mental health. And again, this definition actually comes from the World Health Organization. And again, it actually brings out this idea that it's more than just one thing. What they haven't done within the World Health Organization is add spirituality. So that's not added into their definition of mental health there. Again, I'll leave you to read that. There's also a definition of what is mental health problems and why do they occur. And again, we'll look at reasons for that in a minute. I've also said in the notes there that it's actually 1 in 5 people will actually be affected by a mental health problem within any one given year. I just read stats just recently that said one in four people with any one given year will experience some kind of mental health problem. Yes, Cliff?
Yeah, this one in four thing seems to be a common theme.
Yeah.
That's how I would understand the notion of mental illness at the moment. A lot of health issues, the magic ratio seems to be one in four. So I'm really quite intrigued by that.
Okay, well let me give you another stat then. 43% they're saying of our community will experience some form of mental health in their given lifetime. So again, it's quite high, isn't it? It's actually quite high. And again, if you look at one in four, that's one in four of us here could be experiencing some form of mental health. Now, don't look around at anyone. No, I think it might be you. But could be experiencing some form of mental health problem. So it's quite common within our community for that to happen. Yes, Paul?
I'm just going to mention too that a lot of depression and things are caused by chemical imbalance.
Yeah, and we'll look at that in a minute too. Yeah. So again, it's quite prevalent and it's quite common, and yet we still stigmatise it, and it still seems to get locked away. I love it for the day when we actually talk about people experiencing mental health problems just as commonly as my wife talks about having diabetes.
Yes.
I'd love it for us to get to that stage where we've actually taken away the stigma and the language that continues to shame and actually help people to be able to see that. But again, it will be one in four. And again, depression is actually climbing and will continue to climb to the point where it's actually affecting our health quite dramatically. We'll still be killing ourselves with heart attacks, apparently. But again, depression will be on the rise.
The one in four isn't about severe things.
No. No.
One in four is when you could be anxious for a little while.
Mm-hmm.
And for whatever reason, anxiety.
Yeah. And again, what you'll find is people are on the spectrum. And we're the same, by the way. We're all on the spectrum. So, you know, we could have it where we're actually living and enjoying good mental health, and we're enjoying those things that provide us with good mental health. We could also be slipping down the other way to those things that actually create the potential for mental health problems. And we're always sliding up and down that scale, depending on what's going on for us, and depending on the supports we have. And again, those supports are really important. And again, often we need those supports around us, but we need supports that where we can actually be open and honest, and vulnerable, and all those things that still be accepted and valued and cared for. You'll see there that I put in a list of what we would call the mental illnesses. So there's just a general list there. You also need to be aware that more and more within the mental health service we're having to deal with personality stuff. Have people heard of personality disorders? And when I first started 18 years ago, we would only ever focus in on the mental illness stuff. So bipolar, psychosis, schizophrenia stuff, anxiety, depression, all those kinds of things. That would be our main focus. More and more, we're actually focusing in on now on that personality stuff. And again, we often get people coming into our service who are experiencing personality problems, personality disorders, and they're difficult to deal with. And they can also be experiencing a mental health problem at the same time. And again, so more and more we're having to actually deal with that. And what I'm finding is a lot of churches now are having to deal with it as well. And they're more the difficult people. And so again, for many congregations I'm actually working with is, you know, they have people who are difficult to deal with because they actually have a personality. Do you people know what I mean by personality? Yeah? I mean, personality is really important, by the way. Personality actually helps us to be able to have good relationships. It helps us to be able to deal with stress, helps us to be able to have a good emotional range, also helps us to have insight. Again, if you don't have much insight, you're not going to grow or change. And it's that ability to be able to stand back. For people that have personality problems, their buckets in those areas are not very big. And so again, they become very reliant on other people for lots of things. But again, more and more, we're having to deal with those kinds of issues. So let's go over the page. Again, one of the things that a lot of my people often deal with is the fact that we have no kind of concrete way of kind of defining whether a person has a particular illness or not. One of my people, she gave me her file to read the other day, and she'd been diagnosed with 6 different illnesses on the right. And she was really frustrated with that, by the way. But has anyone ever heard of the DSM-5R?
Yes.
It's the latest diagnostic statistic, so it has all the mental health illnesses in it. So it is about that wide, and it's A4 size, so it's great at keeping a door open if ever you need to. But it contains all the various criteria, signs and symptoms for mental illness. And the problem for a lot of people is the doctors or whoever's kind of diagnosing people can only use those signs and symptoms that people present with. So if someone presents with certain signs and symptoms, then they'll get diagnosed with a certain illness, which can be really frustrating for a lot of people. For some people, when they first get diagnosed, they are just so glad that someone has finally been able to tell them what's going on. And it gives them something to be able to understand what's been happening for them. For a lot of people, it can be really frustrating because they're trying to work out what are the signs and symptoms, and I've been diagnosed with this and this, and I'm on this medication, those kinds of things. So again, it can be really frustrating. And again, just quickly, I want to look at the idea of what creates the potential for mental health problems or for mental illness. And again, I think it's really important that people think about what kind of models they use to help people understand why they actually get mental illness, mental health problems. The model you use will actually determine how you react to that person or how you respond to them or how you actually help them. And again, we need to be very careful with that. And I've seen lots of things within churches where people have come up with specific things that are just not helpful. In fact, I have a list of churches that I will send people to and a list of churches I won't send people to. Because again, they have particular models or ideas that really don't help the person to get well. And so again, we need to be very aware of what kind of models we use to help people to understand why they've got this particular problem or illness going on in their lives. Now, the model I use is the stress model. And again, if I were to take all of you here now, and I chuck you all in the back of a semi and just left you rolling around while I drove around the streets of Adelaide for a while, and I got you highly distressed, and then I dropped you off at some kind of factory where it was, you know, there was no comforts at all, and I made you work and work with no sleep, very little food, water. Within 3 days, you'd all be showing signs and symptoms of mental health problems. So it doesn't take much before we actually start tipping into some form of mental health problems. So stress is a really important factor in becoming unwell. And again, for a lot of people, what often happens is they build up periods of stress, and stress upon stress, and guess what? They decompensate and tip into some form of mental health problem. So again, whatever model you use, you need to be quite aware of how it affects the person you're working with or being alongside with or providing pastoral care with. If you think it's only just one factor, I'm going to say you're sadly mistaken. One of the things I hear often is if they just get off the drugs, everything would be okay. I hate that. Because I think there are a whole lot of other things that play in that person's life that has caused that potential for them to develop some form of mental health problem. So again, we need to be aware of the models we use and the language we use around people. But I've stuck to the stress model for a number of years now. I find it's really useful for people. Because what it does is it actually puts the model out in front of them so they can actually look at what's going on, what's happening around them, what are the issues that they're kind of facing. And it also then helps them to start looking at how can I get better or how can I recover? What are the things I need to put in place to do this better so that I stay well? Because that makes sense for people. But again, you need to think about this and you need to think about how would I explain this to someone? Because you're going to get asked it at some stage, by the way. And I've had people ask me, you know, is this God doing this to me? All kinds of things. And so we need to be aware that we will be asked at some stage, why did this happen to me? What's going on? So I talk about the stress model. And again, I realise that there are genetic factors in play for people. And if you look back through my family history, we have depression up the wazoo. In fact, I can see it through my parents, my grandparents, and even into my great-grandparents, that we have a long history of depression. There is some kind of genetics going on there that is kind of handed down. And I've been to be aware of that over the years, that that's one of the stress factors I can. Does that make sense for people? So we know that happens. We also know that there are chemical imbalances that go on for people. And that's why we use medications. And again, medications often help people to be able to get the balance right again. So again, we need to be able to help people to do that. And again, you need to think about how you feel about medication as well. I've come across lots of churches who actually say if you're using medication, there's something wrong with you. Oh no, you hear it often. And I often say to people, when, you know, I've heard people make those comments, and I say to them, well, would you say that to my wife who has diabetes, that she should stop taking medication? And they say, oh no. But because it's a mental health problem and you're getting medications that help you with your mental health, people often, I don't know why they do it, but they often say if you're using medication, then somehow God's not in this, all that kind of stuff. And I've heard that. So we need to be careful around the kind of how we think about medications and how we talk to people about them. And again, we need to be aware sometimes of how medications affect people. Now, I tend to carry around a little drug dictionary with me. You can pick them up from your local news agency, but for a lot of my people, they're on quite a lot of drugs, and they have quite a lot of side effects, by the way. And so often, it's a matter of talking people through and saying, okay, this is what you're on, this is what it's meant to do. Is it doing that? There are some side effects, and how are they affecting you? And sometimes I've actually been to GPs and doctors and actually gone there to say, this medication is actually causing this big side effect for this person, and is there a way we can change or modify this? In fact, for one of the ladies I was working with, she was losing her hair. And for her, that was really important for her to keep her hair instead of it coming out in clumps. We looked through the, you know, that little drug dictionary, and one of the things we found was that one of the side effects could be losing hair. And she went back to her doctor and said, I think this is a side effect. And he just said, oh, no, it's not. I had to go there with her at some stage and say, look, this is what's happening for her. Is there a way we can change this or redo this? And fortunately with me there, the doctor said, oh, I think we can do this. But again, it stopped her hair from falling out. She actually felt ashamed to go out in public because, you know, her hair was falling out. So again, those kinds of things are really important. So we know there are chemical imbalances going on. And again, you know, I had one person who got a head injury from riding a motorbike. Decided he was going to ride his motorbike, no helmet. Spat himself off the thing, hit his head, ended up with having psychosis or schizophrenia. And again, this chemical imbalance stuff went on from the brain injury. So we know that happens for people. We know there are things like environmental stresses that go on for people that can actually affect how they view themselves and how they view their world. And again, remember when 9/11 happened? Again, our units were chock-a-block full with people, overflowing, because the world for them suddenly became unsafe, unsure. And it created a kind of a stress. Even for a lot of the people I've worked with, even living in Davern Park, there was an environmental stress going on that was actually affecting people and what was happening for them. And again, we often live with this environmental stress without taking notice of it, but for a lot of people it actually affects how they live their lives, how they do their lives. And so again, we need to be aware of those kinds of things. Some of the other stresses people live with are the social kind of stress. So some events can be stressful and they'll actually affect the person. They'll perhaps affect their identity, affect things like meaning and purpose, which is really big for people, by the way. You know, my picture of who I was has suddenly changed. And so those kinds of things can happen again. Things like relationship breakdown, loss of job, unemployment, change in school, all those kinds of things can actually affect people and cause them very high stress. And again, it's interesting the kind of stresses people can experience. If you look at some of the stress scales around the place, Christmas can be highly stressful. In one scale I looked at, it only had this 12 points out of 100, but I think for some of my people it's higher than that. But you know, those kind of social stresses around for people can actually increase their stress load quite dramatically without them even realising it. There can be things like psychological stress. So how people actually manage or deal with stress is really important. And that's why the things around like Seligman, and you'll hear a lot of talk lately around resilience. Have you heard that stuff around the place? People learning to be resilient, all those kinds of things. How we actually cope and manage with stress is really important. And again, for some people, they've not been taught that. Or they don't have the skills or the ability to be able to do it, which reduces their ability to manage stress, which increases their stress load. Does that make sense for people? So again, those kinds of things can happen for people. There are also things like spiritual factors. And again, I think our spirituality is really important. And spirituality is really important because it again talks about our meaning, our purpose, our identity, who's there to support us, higher power, all those kinds of things. And again, it can really affect people quite greatly. I had someone that I was talking to just recently, and for them, their spirituality was knocking them around hugely. They said to me, "Mark, I never take communion." And I said, "Oh, why don't you take communion?" And she said to me, "Mark, I'm never good enough to be able to take communion." So the thing around spirituality is really important. But again, you get stress upon stress upon stress, and guess what? You're going to tip into some kind of form of mental health problem, mental illness, those kinds of things. Now, when I talk to people about this, I've always had good response from people. Because it's actually not blaming a thing. You know, and often people are told, if only you just do this, everything would be all right. Well, if only that were true. But again, it actually helps people to look at it, and start looking at the things that will actually help them to be well and to do well. And again, it's a good model to be able to do that with. And again, with a lot of people I work with, we actually look at the idea of dealing with stress earlier than what they normally would. And for a lot of people, they don't pick up their stress level. Some of us here probably aren't very good at picking up our stress levels either. And so again, being able to manage that and be aware of that is really important. But again, that's the model I would use. And that's the model I find that's helped people over a number of years to be able to help them, to be able to understand why this has happened to them. But again, it's non-blaming. It puts it out there so they can begin to look at it. You need to think about what kind of models you would use. Because again, it will determine how you will actually speak to people, be around people, and again, the kind of help you'll be able to provide or offer people. So again, you need to be aware of those kinds of things. And again, really important to be able to do. The other thing that I think is still big on the agenda is the idea of stigma. And again, I know for a lot of people, stigma is really one of the things that eats at them. Now, over my years within the life of the church, I've actually experienced a lot of stigma because I work in mental health. Sounds really strange, doesn't it? But often you go to meetings and stuff and people say, "Oh, Mark, what do you do?" And sometimes I don't want to tell people. Because I say, "Oh, I work in mental health." And what they'll say to you, "Mark, well, that must be really hard." And then that's where the conversation ends. They kind of walk off and leave you and think, "Okay, what did I do wrong here?" But it's that idea of stigma can come and actually affect people. And I've experienced that over years. And it's something I've actually had to continue to work through over a number of years because it actually has affected me in my role and my role to be able to work with people. But again, for people who experience that stigma stuff, it's really hard, especially around the mental illness stuff. And I actually think it stops people from being able to talk openly about what's going on for them and how they're being affected. And again, often and people who ask me, Mark, what are you doing? Again, I don't want to tell people. Because I'm going to have at least 6 or 7 conversations where someone comes up to me and says, Mark, can I talk to you for a few minutes? So again, you know, it creates the potential, but sometimes it also creates the dilemma. But again, I think stigma is still a wall of silence around people, and it leaves people scared to be able to talk about what's going on for them. And yet the most important thing they need is that support, and that empathy, and that walking alongside. Now, I've got a little poem here. It's called The Thesaurus of Madness. It's written by Sandy Jeffs. Is anyone? Her poetry is just great. If you get a chance, Sandy has actually had schizophrenia for a number of years, and she writes on her experience of what it's like. But she's called this as The Thesaurus of Madness, and it brings out the idea that a lot of our language is loaded. And we actually have more language to describe mental health problems than we do when explaining what sanity is, by the way. We have one word to describe what sanity is, and that's sanity. We've got lots of other words to describe what mental health problems are. So let me read this to you. She goes on to write, people must think I'm crazy. Being the mad woman, I'm also a lunatic, a maddie, a mental case, a bedlamite, a screwball, a nut, a loon, a loony, a madcap, a mad dog, a psychopath, a maniac, an hysteric, a psychotic, a manic depressive, megalomaniac, a pyromaniac, a kleptomaniac, a crackpot, an eccentric, an oddity, an idiot, a basket case, demented, moonstruck, hazy, unhinged, dippy, loopy, distracted, pixie-led, a scatterbrain, certifiable, crazy, loco, psycho, a nutter, possessed, fevered, bonkers, obsessed, bedeviled, tropostarco, schizo, potty nuts, daft, dilly, a crack brain, a fruitcake, touched. Being insane, I suffer from mental illness, psychiatric illness, brain damage, unsoundness of mind, alienation, lunacy, madness, mental derangement, mental instability, abnormal psychology, loss of reason, intellectual unbalance, mental decay, a darkened mind, a troubled brain, a deranged intellect, nerves, imbecility, cretinism, morosis, feeble-mindedness, queerness, having a screw loose, bats in the belfry, rats in the upper story, nervous breakdowns. Being as I am, mad that is, I must be bananas, crackers, a camel short of a caravan, a ball short of an over, a pad short of a kit, not in my right mind, bereft of reason, deprived of my wits, as mad as a snake, a tinny short of a slab, diseased in the mind, as mad as a hatter, wielded in my wits, not the full quid, a brick short of a load, off my rocker, round the bend, a candidate for bedlam, foaming at the mouth, as mad as a meat axe, up the pole, a sandwich short of a picnic, out of my tree, off my face, off my block, over the edge, off my saucer, a shilling short of a pound, as silly as a wheel, off my trolley, as mad as a two-bob watch, a shingle short, and I have a kangaroo loose in the top paddock. Being wilted and distraught, I live in a madhouse, a mental home, a mental hospital, an asylum, a lunatic asylum, an insane asylum, bedlam, a booby hatch, a loony bin, a nut house, a bug house, a psychiatric hospital, the rat house, the giggle factory, the rat factory, the funny farm. She goes on to say, I am many things in many places. Fool that I may be, mad that I may be, I am in all my precarious guises the creation of a cruel mind. It's pretty powerful, isn't it? And so again, what this really encourages to do is to continue to think about how we use language. Language is very powerful, and it affects the people around us, and it affects the people who are experiencing mental illness, mental health problems in a huge way. There is one word, if you come up to me and you use it, I'm probably likely to slap you. And that's schizophrenic. I hate that word with passion. It's often used to describe people who are violent and crazy and loopy and do all these bad things within our community. And yet the reality is that people who experience mental health problems are more likely to experience violence than the other way around. Using that word schizophrenic is describing a person, not an illness. I much prefer people use the word either psychosis or schizophrenia. The person has schizophrenia, they are not an illness. So again, we need to be very careful with how we use our language, because it creates space for people to be able to talk about things. Now, I often don't talk about the word mental illness either. I often talk about the idea of people having mental health problems. And again, I'm trying to find ways to actually use language that help people to feel safe to talk about what's going on for them. And I find when I do that, it actually creates a space for people to do that. And one of the things I've found that's really important is if people feel safe, they'll do the work. They'll actually do the work they need in order to recover. So a lot of my work is often done around trying to create safe space for people so they can actually talk about what's going on, so they find the resources they need in order to be well. But language is really important, and we need to be quite careful with it. Again, it's one of the reasons why I don't use the word sin. It's loaded for people. And again, it actually, you know, when I use those kinds of words for a long time, people, they just cringe and shut up. So again, we need to be careful with how we use our language and how we actually help people to find those safe places. But again, that issue, I think, is really important within our culture. I'm glad to see it's changing around the idea of depression, anxiety. That's actually, you know, we're doing more work around that within our community. And I think some people now are feeling more empowered to be able to talk about depression, anxiety, but the other forms of illness, not so much. But again, I think we can do that for people. So again, we need to be aware of our language and how we use it. In fact, I even think we need to be aware sometimes of our theology and how we use our theology. Up in the north, we actually had a faith community. And we started that because people came up to me one day and said, "Mark, we want to do church when we go away on camp." What we used to do is go away on camps every now and then, because we found a lot of people never got out of their area. And so they came and said, "Mark, we'd like to go away and we want to have church." So I said, "What's church?" We need to be quite clear on what church was. So we went away and we did church, and we came back and I said, "Mark, we want to keep doing this." So we actually started our own kind of little faith community, meet in one of the rehab units, and then we would actually meet up at the hospital on a very regular basis. Until we came to the point where it's now recognised as part of a faith community within the United Church. But we were very clear on what our theology was. And we're actually very clear on what our guidelines were as well. And again, one of the things I often find as churches is we're not very clear on what our guidelines are. And we're often not very clear what our theology is either. But again, within that life of that group, every week we would say what our theology was. And we would say what our guidelines were. And again, it created a safe place for people. So they could actually come and recognise that God was present with them, God was present there with them, and God would continue to be present there with them. And again, it was one of the best things I ever did. I just loved it to pieces, because I felt I could be safe there too. Which is quite amazing, I found. So again, the idea is sometimes we need to be quite clear on what our theology is and be able to articulate that in a way that creates safety for people is really, really important. Okay, haven't got long. Sorry, you're getting about 2 hours stuff in about an hour, by the way. And this is normally a lot more interactive as well. Someone can ask a question? No?
I was going to ask a question about the stigma question. You feel a stigma. I'm wondering whether or not, in fact, sometimes people don't want to engage in questions about mental health because they have some doubts about their own. And so, therefore, to raise the question and talk about it, in fact, makes them feel unsafe.
Oh, yes, it could be. Yeah. Also, a lot of people are not willing to talk about it because what I found for a lot of people is they're frightened of talking to someone else about it because they're really frightened of saying something to that person that may upset them.
Because so we don't become violent.
Well, maybe. Or get upset.
Get upset.
You know, or get unwell, that kind of stuff. So, you know, for a lot of people, that's the issue or the problem. And that's, you know, we need to deal with our own fear around that. You know, so again, there's a lot of fear around mental health still. You know, sometimes people think it rubs off. And I don't think it does. The other thing I want to talk about is recovery is actually long-haul ministry. For people who get diagnosed with an illness, it's not simply just going into hospital, being put on medication, then coming out and all being well. The they would say that there's someone who has their first bout of psychosis or schizophrenia, that it can actually take up to a year to recover. If you have a second or third bout, it can take 3 to 5 years to recover. It's a long time, isn't it? And so again, when people come out of hospital, we need to continue to make sure they're supported and cared for in a way that helps them in that recovery process. And not just assume that because they're out of hospital, they're just going to be well and get on. That's not going to happen. Because again, illness often wipes people out. Their ability to concentrate, their ability to be motivated, all those kinds of things just gets pushed out the window for a period of time. And so they often need help to be able to kind of process and work through issues. The other thing I'd like to talk about and just finish up with is the idea of grief. And again, for a lot of people who experience mental illness, I think there's a whole lot of grief that is attached. In fact, within the mental health service, a colleague and I started running grieving and mental illness groups. And the reason we started doing that was because people would get upset. And the reply would be, well, you either settle down or we'll drug you up or lock you up. And for us, that didn't seem quite appropriate. And what we realised for a lot of people was they're actually grieving. And being diagnosed with an illness often means there's lots of loss and change. So for a lot of people, and again, with one group I did a while ago, they named 40 losses and changes they went through because they've been diagnosed with an illness. That's a lot. And there are significant losses, like loss of family, loss of friends, loss of job, loss of status. For some people, loss of housing, loss of employment. The fact that they now have to live with an ongoing illness and how are they going to manage that. So a change in lifestyle, all kinds of stuff went on for people. And again, I think we need to be aware that often people will be going through a grieving process. And often some of the things we can do is to help them to be able to name what's going on and help them to be able to process that and work through that. But again, for a lot of people, they would go through a grieving process and it takes time to be able to do that. Now, unfortunately, we're not good at doing that within our community. We don't often acknowledge grief as being an important thing. In fact, I remember just recently I did a funeral for someone and we'd done the funeral in the chapel and then we were going to go to the graveside. We actually had to step inside into the road to get the hearse across the road because no one would stop. I don't think we recognise grief as much as we used to within our community. And if we can't recognise it for someone who's close to us who's died, then we're not going to recognise it for a whole bunch of other things. And so again, I think it's important to help people to be able to deal with that grief stuff. Because again, if we can help people to deal with that grief stuff, what we're actually doing is reducing the stress load. So they don't actually have stress upon stress. And again, if you're interested, there's a book written by Virginia LaFond, or we'll put it up on the website. But she's written a book called Grieving and Mental Illness. It's a lovely book. And it actually helps people to step through this whole process what grief is, but she was someone who was, she was a social worker, you know, had a master's, all kinds of stuff, and then ended up being diagnosed with bipolar, and then recognised she was going through her own grieving stuff, and so, so again, it comes with a good lot of experience, but again, often I find people are going through a grieving process, and that's why they're getting upset, and so we need to help them in that process. It's 9 o'clock. Has anyone got any questions or thoughts or ideas they want to finish up with?
I think the same thing we do with through hospice, through families, is that depression is so often thrown up and misinterpreted. And, you know, I spend a lot of the course saying grief is normal, grief is natural. Yet there's been a huge void created in your life. You're missing that person that you've gone for so long. And that's normal and natural. And, you know, don't restrict it. Express yourself. Release your emotions. And yet so many people say, oh, you shouldn't be grieving, you shouldn't be this. Go to the doctor, stop up with pills. As mental illness, as depression. And I think mental illness depression is a long way removed.
And again, I think within our Christian community, we have a whole bag of resources to help people. I love reading Psalms. brainstorm, so I see this whole kind of grieving process going on. And you see people say and do all these incredible things in their grieving. And again, we need to be able to give people permission to be able to do that. So look, I hope that's been helpful for you. Again, if you want me to come to some of your congregations or your communities, I'm happy to do that. I'm happy to provide a list of some of the stuff I can actually bring and actually help work through with some of the stuff around mental health. I provide notes, like you've got notes tonight. All my books come with notes, so people can actually go away with resources and stuff to be able to help them be able to do that better. So thank you.
Thank you, Mark. You've seems to be very, very narrowly scratched the surface of these issues, and it raises more questions for me than answers, but that's fine, even though I've done some psychology, and it's certainly there's a different way. That stress model is certainly something that is great, and I thank you for the offer to come to our congregations if they want to look more at this and actually become more competent in dealing with mental issues. So thanks again. So looking at your newsletters, and we'll be abroad to you next time. Just look at North of the City, it's fantastic. And we're finished on time, which is marvellous, mate. Here's two items. Brian wants two items, so as I said, I'll wait till it's on top.
Has everyone filled in the roles?
Yeah.
So that's gone all year round. Wonderful.
Thank you.
Now, also with that on the YouTube, how many people have looked at things on YouTube before, on websites? Now, you'll notice, if you click onto the YouTube on the COMN website, you can then scroll down and you can make comments on the script. So, if you click on tonight's topic and scroll down, you can make a comment, and you can comment on comments. So you can have a running commentary going between a group of you on the YouTube, and you can put live. So hopefully everyone will put live and then we'll come to the topic. Because Lorraine's doing such a wonderful job for us with these, and she's really enjoying putting them on YouTube. So I encourage you to have a look on the YouTube and scroll down and make comments, positive comments, naturally. And comment on comments and get a conversation going.
And lastly, I'd like to thank you all for coming out. It was a lovely night, and for engaging in the conversations, and to continue to have them. A benediction. It's time to go. Time to re-engage with the world. To put the faith into deeds, to practice gracious love, to share boundless hope. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. With the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.